my name's Brian Monk. We live on 5,180 acres, and we moved out there because we love the bush.
I'm Ruth Armstrong, and we're at Cecil Plains. We grow crops. This is a cropping farm, and this is a cropping district. It is a very rich farming area, and I think it's regarded as some of the best farmland in the world.
It's a perfect place to live.
We've got three kids, and we're trying to make a living out of farming.
My name is Mabel Quackerwood and I'm a Bailey elder from Gladstone area.
Country for me is sacred. Curtis Island is in our ancestral grounds. All our ancestors were buried there.
I'm Graham Gibson and I'm here in Broke growing grapes and have been for the last 23 odd years. And we've been, since 2004, trying to ensure that our lifestyle, our business, our property values, our environment is saved from being a gas field.
Since Coal Seam Gas came along, I can safely say our life has been devastated, for want of a better description. It's completely shattered any plans and any future that we thought that we had. It's affected our health, it's affected our mental health to no end, and it's also put our entire life into disarray.
Living in a gas field, I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. I honestly would not. This is hell. We don't know what's going to happen.
Having your community in a gas field is a worrying thing, you know.
Here we go. I've never been an activist. I've never been an environmentalist. But it's like this is of a scale that is beyond comprehension. This is Australia.
This is an invasion. And it's an invasion which betrays common sense. This is an invasion of Australia.
Right across our vast continent, an invasion is taking place. From our precious food bowls in the Darling Downs, Gippsland, the Liverpool Plains, and the rich farmlands of southeast South Australia, to tourist makers like northern New South Wales, the Otway Coast, Queensland's scenic rim, and Western Australia's wildflower country. The gas companies want it all. Our greatest underground water resource, the Great Artesian Basin, is also at risk. As are the drinking water catchments for the Sydney region, which supply over 4 million people. Even our iconic natural and cultural locations are under threat. The Kimberley, Central Australia, Arnhem Land, and the Ningaloo region. It seems that nothing is sacred and nowhere is safe.
I think as a whole, this community naively felt that this area is so special and so important as an agricultural resource. There's no way in the world that they'll ever be mining here. Like, it's just stupid.
In just a few short years, coal seam gas, or CSG production, has transformed the Darling Downs of southern Queensland, one of Australia's most productive farming regions, into an unrecognisable landscape. Some 18,000 wells have been approved, with tens of thousands more planned.
In 2004, Sydney Gas arrived with a drilling rig, which is the first we knew that there was going to be any drilling up here, because you don't find out until they arrive.
The first easement they wanted to put through our place was diagonally past the front of our house. They only tell you the good part about it until they start, and then you find out that there's pipelines going north, south, east and west, and wherever they feel fit to go.
Representatives of the gas companies, you know when they're lying because their lips are moving. It is all about getting their company onto your property to extract a resource, often at your property's detriment.
Unconventional forms of gas, such as coal seam gas, shale gas and tight gas, differ from natural gas because they're more difficult to extract and can't be developed with conventional processes. Unconventional gas production is highly invasive above and below ground, requiring massive numbers of wells and intrusive extraction methods, such as horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing, or fracking.
This industrialises your region. It's your whole region turns into a factory, a gas factory.
It is not an industry that has a light environmental footprint, despite all the lies their spin doctors go on with and the massive advertising campaigns that they've engaged in, saying that they're clean and green. They're not.
This is my land. It's also one of Australia's biggest coal seam gas reserves.
Santos are currently running ads designed to induce, in those who see them, a sense of feeling that this is all pretty mundane, straightforward, very safe. Well, they don't tell you what the ads should tell us. They're frightened to show us a map of the gas wells and what they look like. They're frightened to show us a map of the all-weather roads that we needed to service the gas wells. They're frightened to show us a map of the topsoil, which will need to be removed for pipe construction to connect the gas wells. They're frightened to tell us where the employees will go because they'll have recreational needs and they'll need to be administrative quarters. They're frightened to tell us that these coal seam gas initiatives will become large industrial estates. They don't tell us any of this. They will require many, many hectares. Santos don't tell us how many compressors they will need. They don't tell us what they'll do with the gas or the water. They say nothing about the reverse osmosis treatment plant, which you'll be able to hear for miles. They don't tell us once the water is treated where you'll store it, because the volumes will be greater than several Sydney harbours. They don't tell us where they'll put the residue. They don't tell us where the salt will go or what it will do to the soil. They don't tell us that it's a 24/7 operation. In other words, they don't tell us what a fully blown gas field looks like.
In the end, I consider the resource sector as the biggest enemy of farming in Australia, by far.
They talk about coal and gas as a major resource. Water is our most crucial resource by a long, long way. And if we don't protect our water, we're doomed, in my opinion.
Really, what's happening to the groundwater resource is the most critical question. And that's the sort of stuff that we still haven't got good data. We haven't understood groundwater and the fact that some of the processes going on in groundwater take decades. They don't just go in 1 year, they don't just go in 5 years. Sometimes they take 50 years or more before we realise the problem we've got.
Fracking, or hydraulic fracturing, is a hazardous industrial process that is frequently used in unconventional gas extraction. Fracking involves high-pressure injection of large volumes of water, sand and chemicals into the ground to fracture the source rock and stimulate gas flow. Fracking has resulted in contamination of ground and surface waters with chemicals and methane, which can migrate upwards through subsurface cracks and fissures. Fracking has also been associated with an increased incidence of earthquakes. During coal seam gas extraction, large volumes of groundwater must also be extracted to facilitate gas flow.
This depressurisation will affect the whole groundwater system. Every litre of water you pump out of the ground reduces river flow by the same amount.
We've only got 5 metres left available to pump, and then...
So you've lost two-thirds of your standing water,
that's
essentially.
That's correct, yeah. So if it continues to decline at the rate we are, we've probably only got, you know, 2 years, 2 to 3 years water left here. So it's pretty scary, yeah.
they don't know at this stage how long it'll take to replenish that water, or whether the gas is going to come up out of the ground like it does in the Condamine River.
Within an hour of the Condamine gas bubbling going on YouTube, already Queensland government and industry were saying, no, can't be CSG. By reducing the pressure in the balloon, you're making it easier for gas to flow and therefore easier for it to come up in the Condamine. It's a clear, obvious case that it could be explained by CSG. But there's no recorded history of an event like this in the Condamine, so it's unprecedented.
Shale and tight gas fracturing are extremely water-intensive processes. Each frack, depending on the nature of the well, will use between 10 and 30 million litres of water. Each well will often be fractured multiple times, so up to 7, 8, 9 times over the life of a well, which could be over 20 years. And each time it's fracked, it will require that amount of water. During the drilling process, once again, millions of litres of water are used just to drill the well in the first place.
And then there are the chemicals used in drilling and fracking.
They talk about such little amounts of chemical being used. Well, certainly our research has shown that in many cases they are substantial quantities, up to 18 tonnes per well. Much of that, 40% of that, can never be recovered. And then when you multiply that by the number of wells that the industry envisage, the chemical usage really is phenomenal. And the claim that somehow these chemicals are things that you find under your kitchen sink or in your bathroom cabinet is just absolute rubbish.
These chemicals are carcinogens, they're reproductive toxins, they're chemicals that cause sensitization.
We just don't know what the potential impacts are going to be. And that's not just impacts immediately, this is impacts for generations to come, because once those chemicals have gone into our groundwater, we can't get them out. There's no way of extracting those chemicals.
The three small grandchildren jumped into the bath, bath time's a happy time, and they started screaming. And when they were taken out of the water, they had a ring up to the level of where the water had sat that they were sitting in. And it was like a chemical burn. It genuinely was a chemical burn.
Now, our gas meter says that that's a combustible gas.
We put that bore hose into a drum, and so it's bubbling up, and when we would strike a match, it would ignite.
The other thing that they do is to say there's no evidence that fracking has ever contaminated people's water. But, of course, no baseline studies were done by these companies before they start. So, of course, when these impacts start hitting home, they just simply say, look, this is natural, this has always occurred, and there is no evidence to suggest that we're causing it. No evidence to suggest.
You know, it's the old adage, no data, so there's no problem.
Another unanswered question is, how will they deal with the waste?
Truly, this industry produces so much waste that it just cannot deal with. The water that this industry wants to palm off onto local government, onto farmers, is anything but clean. And it may have everything from methane through to heavy metals to BTEX to a whole range of toxic byproducts still in it.
Look at this. Product water, straight on the church road.
The water is their enemy. They can't deal with the water. They will never deal with the water. Not safely. They can deal with it. They'll fill this river with water. They don't care. They don't care. They're in it. It's only money.
Common practice was to discharge that water into an illike or creek system.
They don't just drill a well. You know, they just don't frack it. They then clean the gas, and it'll be you that breathes it.
Unconventional gas extraction also involves venting, flaring, and wastewater evaporation, which release a wide range of hazardous air pollutants. And then, of course, there are the leaks.
Everything leaks in coal seam gas, can I tell you? Everything leaks. Wells leak, pipelines leak, compressor stations leak, the ground leaks from coal seam gas.
While the industry claims that using CSG will decrease greenhouse emissions, Australian-based researchers have measured elevated levels of methane and other gases in the atmosphere in a Queensland gas field. Methane is a powerful greenhouse gas with an average global warming potential 72 times greater than carbon dioxide over a 20-year period.
The concentration of methane in the atmosphere is consistently higher. The highest concentrations over three times the atmosphere background values.
And if you properly account for those fugitive emissions, you find that the carbon footprint for coal seam gas is no better than coal.
There's been a lot of reports on the stuff from overseas. They've seen the effects of it, and they still want to bring it here. They still want to do it.
But 15 years after the industry starts in the United States, the evidence is now starting to come through. Fracking contaminates groundwater. Fracking is a health hazard, and we need to heed the lessons which are coming out of a place like the US, where they frack the hell out of it now for two decades.
Well, the problem is they were pumping all the people's water wells down, and the gas was coming up their water wells, blowing up their houses or their cisterns or whatever.
We did have artesian wells. They've quit and will never come back.
Communities living near gas fields in the United States have reported a range of health effects since the gas companies moved in. These conditions include serious respiratory ailments, nose, throat, and eye irritations, and neurological illnesses. Residents living adjacent to CSG activities around Tara in Queensland are now also reporting a range of similar symptoms, with particular concern over the neurological impacts on children.
Our second youngest grandson has started to take seizures. And I don't know if they're a chemical poisoning from what they do in gas fields.
We've got children that have metallic tastes come up in your mouth. So with that, it's not just that you've got this tinny taste in your mouth, you can't eat. You get to the point where you start to throw up because it is just so intense, this horrible taste in your mouth. Then we've got the constant headaches. Then you've got the nosebleeds, and I'm not talking about a nosebleed, I'm talking about nosebleeds that last for 3-4 days in a row non-stop. Then we've got little Noah, he has, we don't know what it is, he'll run around, all of a sudden his arms will just go limp. That's it, there's no movement left in him, and this can last anything from 2 minutes to 20 minutes at a time. So we've taken him down to neurosurgeons in Brisbane that have assured us it's not any kind of medical condition that he has. They don't know why he's doing this.
When is it going to be enough to get something done? What, do they have to start dying? Is that what it's going to come down to?
Despite these reports, governments are still refusing to implement health impact studies, and the industry still claims that their operations are safe.
To suggest that it's absolutely safe is quite ridiculous, because nobody can guarantee 100% certainty. The only way you can guarantee that is to not do it.
They just don't want to know about it. They just want to go full steam ahead, get this gas out, get it overseas, and that's that. And at what cost? That doesn't seem to matter.
The stupid thing about the whole process, once the government's approved it, it's a law. It's the law now. And if you're trying to try and stop them, you have to prove that what they're doing is harmful. They don't have to prove that it isn't, because they've already been approved. And so it's just a sweetheart deal with no community input and no recourse.
Across the country, our most important food growing areas are under threat.
The more we find out about the industry, the more we become convinced that the two land uses can't coexist.
I've been very concerned about the beef industry, the possible contamination to the beef industry by these companies, spillage of chemicals or water.
Especially when they get all these thousands of wells, they're talking about 20, 30,000 wells. In time, something's going to go wrong and there'll be contamination. they could be eating that contaminated meat before it's been detected.
Some of their infrastructure is already starting to fail. So my question is, well, at this early stage of their development, why should we feel comfortable that a massive expansion isn't just going to see an exponential growth of those problems? What that will mean is a direct contamination of the soil and the water.
Driven entirely by the profit motive, gas companies seek to extract every last cubic foot of gas. They do not see farms, businesses, and communities. They see a collection grid. Under most circumstances, landholders do not have the right to veto access to their property by gas companies.
There's a lot of stress in people, especially people that are too farmers or graziers, and they can see their livelihoods being affected.
Once that industry comes into the area, your land is virtually unsaleable. So for agricultural producers, this is just devastation. Whether they have coal seam gas on their property or next door to them or down the road.
Farmers don't have superannuation, or very rarely. Their farm is the superannuation. The valuation is going to go down to nearly nothing, and we'll be on the pension.
Lights can be a problem, and they'll have these big high-powered lights going because they're drilling 24 hours a day. Of a night time, all around the horizon, you can see glows of wells or infrastructure that's got lights on it.
Staggering increases in traffic, constant noise from infrastructure, and intimidating levels of surveillance and security personnel are also impacting rural communities. As rural landscapes are industrialized, the emotional and psychological impacts on local residents often result in widespread anxiety, anger, and depression.
People can get very despairing. I mean, when you see the size of the corporations involved, and when people realise what we have at stake, you know, the loss of our magnificent farmlands, the industrialisation of extremely beautiful landscapes, this really tears at people's hearts.
It is probably a greater cause of mental illness than even the drought.
When they're faced with uncertainty of knowing what's going to happen to their town, to their area, people aren't sure that they're going to be able to continue to make a living from what they have been doing, sometimes for generations. And that's incredibly stressful.
Mining projects can be devastating for regional communities. People often think that mining is a big employer. All of mining in Australia only employs 2% of the workforce. It's a very capital intensive industry, so it doesn't require that many people to do it. The important thing to remember is it also destroys jobs in other industries, particularly in manufacturing, tourism and agriculture.
In Broke, of course, there's a huge wine tourism industry, and that industry will just expire if it turns into a gas field.
These projects are actually crowding out more jobs than they're creating.
Are those people being sourced locally? Are they being sourced within the state, let alone are they being sourced within Australia? Because many of them are fly in, fly out, they don't spend their income locally. We see examples where rentals have absolutely gone through the roof. How does that benefit any person who wants to stay in that community, who can't afford to rent there anymore because they just don't make enough money? So you're having all these, not just individuals, but all these families that are being disenfranchised from the place that they've grown up in, from the places that they love.
I recently went up to Queensland. It's the complete devastation of the social fabric of the towns. Everybody is in hate mode in a way. And while I was there, I found one person that was for it. He owned the pub. He said, I'm making a fortune.
They have come, they've divided and they've conquered. People don't understand the impact. It's a huge impact.
They bring nothing to the table, and we ask them, what do you bring to us? What have you got that we want? They can't answer the question.
We're extracting all this huge amount of gas, and because we're exporting it all, that means that gas in Australia becomes linked to global prices. So the price we pay is likely to double or triple in the next few years.
But it's not just our farmland, rural industries and communities that are under threat. Iconic natural areas right across the country are also at risk. Areas like the Pilliga Forest, the largest temperate woodland left in eastern Australia.
It's just a vast 600,000 hectares of just diverse, wonderful country here. It's just the last place I'd put a gas field.
Right now, they are broad scale knocking down thousands and thousands of hectares of country, and it's perfectly legal.
Where previously there was sufficient continuous habitat, and from a wildlife management point of view, and from a biodiversity point of view, for it to be truly effective, it has to be continuous. And when you have removal of vegetation of that size, it has a massive impact across the board.
The amount of environmental weeds that are going to come in with this huge amount of disturbance, it's got me really worried. The fires are going to be bigger, more intense, and you really don't want fires around a gas field, you'd think. You know, it's crazy what they're doing here.
This craziness extends to the natural and cultural jewels of remote Australia. The Top End, the Red Centre, and the Kimberley. The gas companies want it all. Our international tourism icons and last wild places will be carved up and industrialised.
Kimberley is an area that contains staggeringly large amounts of shale and tight gas. It's one of the five largest onshore gas basins in the world. These companies are quite aggressive, they're very well run, and they're planning on getting this gas online very soon. And we've estimated that there could be well over 100,000 wells within the next 20 years or so.
Even Australia's most remarkable natural gift, the Great Barrier Reef, is currently being despoiled by massive gas export developments.
Well, the risk on Curtis Island is they're putting all these big tanks over there and they freeze the gas into the tanks and they go out onto the wharves and right out to the middle of the ocean. And at the present moment, we have silt that has gone out 35 kilometres out to sea. All the fish in the dugong are dying because they have nothing to eat and they're all putting lesions on the fish and giving them red eyes and everything, this silt is.
CSG proposals were being accelerated. We were being pushed by the big players within the CSG industry, huge players. The thing that I find most alarming is just the sheer enormity of the coal seam gas and the resource industry's developments. It is just amazing, just the sheer enormity of it.
New mapping by the Lock the Gate Alliance using government data shows that approximately 408 million hectares of our land is covered by gas exploration and production licenses or license applications and releases. That's 53% of Australia and an area 17 times the size of Great Britain.
Our country's been destroyed before our eyes. We are seeing a change in our nation.
Because what coal seam gas and open cut coal mining are making into industrial zones now, in 30 years, they'll be industrial wastelands.
We don't trust mining companies. Mining companies, they just come, kill the land, kill the trees, kill the animals. And what they leave, they just leave their mess behind. And we're the ones who are going to suffer long term. We're the ones.
Once extracting gas is no longer commercially viable, well, they will stop and they will move on. But 5-10 years later, we see all this massive damage occurred. It's going to be closer to the trillions, not the billions. Who's going to foot the bill for that? Well, I expect that it's probably going to be the community. But the community as a whole didn't want it.
People in the city have got to see that this is about them as well. This is not just about farmers. It's not just about rural people. It's about all Australia. What sort of Australia do we want?
What are our future energy options? Should we just continue to keep digging, or drilling, as the case may be with CSG, or should we actually really be looking at actually what are more viable future energy systems?
The clear challenge for humanity is to get from an energy present, which is dependent upon fossil fuels, to an energy future, which is non-polluting and sustainable. That's the challenge.
This is where we're going to take a stand to make sure that for future generations, there is something left here, that it isn't polluted and contaminated. It isn't just about now, it's about tomorrow and the next day. And so how can we make a difference? We can make a difference by doing things like lock the gate.
There's a bright side to all of this, and the bright side is that we're seeing the development of a social movement. The lock the gate movement is a major social movement in Australia.
Social movements are probably the most powerful force that citizens have. They're a very, very powerful means of changing society, changing legislation, and that's what's happening with coal seam gas. The power actually lies in the community that this change has to be. And when people have that sort of power, very hard to stop them.
Something really remarkable is happening, and it's like we're one body having an enormous immune reaction to some pathogen. We're mobilising incredibly fast.
Throughout our great land, communities are rising. From the country to the coast, people have locked their gates.
Landowners have locked the gate, communities have locked the gate, you beautiful people here have locked your region up street by street. How good is that?
It's going to be so hard for the companies to come to communities that assert so strongly that they are CSG free.
To see the community actually so engaged and feeling so empowered by finally having their voice heard is really beautiful, because the industry is so very good at divide and conquer, and this is quite the opposite.
I love the uniting of the community. It's really special seeing all walks of life that haven't ever probably come together before, but they're coming together now, and that gave me goosies.
People really are just saying, we've had enough. We've had enough of the industry not listening to us, and we've had enough of government not listening to us.
The government needs to know that the heat is not falling, but it's rising. They either work for us for the next 4 years or they lose that privilege.
This is not a small, noisy minority. It is an issue that is actually reverberating from the north, the south, the east to the west.
We understand that your policies do not protect our people or our country, but this community will protect itself.
We are going to take back the power. We're going to take back the responsibility that governments have just simply shuffled off onto these big corporations.
Right across the land, people are attending marches and rallies, vigils, concerts, and public meetings.
You love this country? Got to fight for it. Because these barbarians are coming, and they're coming with their bulldozers and their drill rigs and their dump trucks. They're coming.
Australians everywhere are putting their bodies on the line at protests and blockades.
The community said, yes, we are going to blockade. We don't care whose farm it is. We cannot have this activity going on in our community.
And we're doing that because governments have failed. And when governments fail,
Ordinary people have to become heroes, and you are heroes.
It's everybody's battle. People get scared about blockading protests. I've never done it before. You know, it's not violent. It's a great sense of community, and we need people. If we don't stop it now, they're going to walk in there. So we may as well say goodbye.
We've been farming for 78 years. We've seen what's happened in Queensland, and we do not want that to happen here. And that is why we're coming out to these blockades. We'll go to every blockade to see what we can do to be a number.
People in a community who are standing up against this is growing daily. The only people who aren't on our side are those who work for the gas companies or hoping to make money from these gas companies. Everybody else is against it.
And how old are you, Linda?
95.
95? And you're all backing this, 100%?
No. He says he's going to arrest me.
And this determined opposition from local communities has already met with success, with three gas companies suspending their operations in New South Wales.
So they're taking up that whole tradition of democracy and claiming back communities.
Knowing that their presence in this community will bring nothing but misery and pain and harm, I have absolutely no problem with sticking it to them.
The fire is well and truly lit. This is the greatest social and environmental movement in Australia's history, and it is gaining enormous momentum. Now is the time to act.
No time for talk. Action. Country is calling. It's now.
And we're going to win. We are unstoppable.
Protect your district from invasive gas fields. Find out how at www.lockthegate.org.au.